For years, savvy Brits have been snapping up bargain properties in Europe.
Oh, wow, it's not been on top of the world.
But some house hunters have bigger dreams than others.
Totally excited, which I'm trying to rein in.
They're on a rescue mission.
You can see the floor's just fallen in.
Big bonfire time.
All over the continent, there are thousands of abandoned villages, hamlets, borgos and quintas lying empty and unloved.
It was just like, wow, this is where we want to be.
On this series, we follow the brave British entrepreneurs risking everything to restore them to their former glory.
I've done too many.
You fenced yourself in.
It's a challenge on an epic scale.
It's huge.
As they're trying to turn back history.
That's the old-fashioned bread oven. They had about five or six families living here.
But can they transform these crumbling settlements?
The upper barn floor decided to give up and I fell through the roof.
Into thriving businesses.
Fingers crossed it's going to be a success.
And beautiful homes.
The actual crowd of people back in the village, this is what we do it for.
Or will their dreams come crashing down?
We haven't had any water for 10 days.
As they restore the past.
It's going to go, it's going to go.
To build their future.
This is just the best place in the world for me.
You've bought a village.
Bought a village.
Coming up, we take a journey back in time and step inside a village of historic cave houses in Spain.
We came up the hill towards it, and when you saw all six caves and the view, it was just like, wow, this is where we want to be.
Could there be new owners for a stunning Italian village?
We like renovating houses, we like entertaining in houses, and we like Italy, so that answers a lot of different things.
And it's the biggest day in a generation for a hamlet in France. But will it be a washout?
I've just been told that if it rains in France on your wedding day, it's lucky.
In Midwest France, about 30 miles from Limoges, and in the heart of the Limousin, there's a tiny hamlet with new proprietors, Ted and Lisa from Norwich. Mormagne once covered 200 acres and had its glory days in the 17th century. The centre of the hamlet was a coaching inn and a relais de poste, a post house where mail riders would change horses before heading off. But when Ted and Lisa bought Mormagne for £160,000 in March 2020, it had been empty for over a decade.
Most people would be quite daunted with the amount of work that there is to do. And there are some times when I look out and I suddenly have a panic attack and think, oh, my God, you know, the budget we've got, where are we going to get to? But it's just so exciting.
The couple don't have much experience renovating, and with a budget of just £80,000, they need to be frugal. But they plan to open a tea room and guest apartments in the main chateau and turn the barns into event spaces.
We don't want to just be here living, earning a business or whatever. We want to fully integrate with the community, and that's hopefully what we can do.
Ted and Lisa's biggest problem so far has been the chateau roof. The timbers date back to 1360. And the ridge tiles are an exquisite example of traditional architecture in this part of France. But some bowed timbers and a missing purlin, one of the vital crossbeams, meant the roof was in danger of collapsing. So they've had to bring in a team of specialists at a cost of around £12,000.
Morning, Graham. How are you? Good morning for it.
Good morning. Nice and sunny.
Expat roofers Graham and Mike have been working on the roof for the last fortnight.
we didn't have the budget for the whole of the roof to be done, and they were the ones that said to us, you know, this area can be done on its own, isolated, just the right side of the tower, which was the desperate part that needed to be repaired because of the big concave in the roof. And most of the quotes that came in said that they couldn't guarantee that they'd be able to keep the ridging on the top.
Yeah, the ridge tiles.
The ridge tiles. That was the main thing. We wanted to keep those ridge tiles, didn't we? Mm.
While Graham and Mike crack on with the roof, Lisa is working in the chateau tea room. And as she chips away at the old mortar, Ted is in the room next door using a laser to measure angles and distances for a suspended ceiling.
So I'm running the brackets in to put the rail on for the suspended ceiling. It makes life a lot easier than having to screw boards straight to the battening.
Outside, though, the roofers have hit a problem. They can't save the ridge tiles and make the roof watertight.
We're working our way along and it's not getting any better. And I'm not happy with the way it is. Well, neither of us are happy with the way it is, really.
If you take them off, can you preserve them? But do you think they'll come off in one piece? You don't know.
It's a shame, but
if they come off in one piece,
we put them somewhere.
Then we put them somewhere. Yeah. They can be featured somewhere else.
We'll try and not smash them up.
Yeah.
Try and go around it.
Yeah.
Lisa is putting a brave face on things, but a few minutes later, the loss of the tiles really hits home.
It's one of the reasons why we love this place so much. It's because of those. The curiosity of what was up there.
And that's what we love about this place, is all the different little things that we come across, which are from different eras and different ages, and you never know how old anything is. But it's nice to keep as much as we possibly can, and the fact that we can't, I'm a little bit upset about.
But it's all right.
It is what it is.
Luckily, Graham and Mike are able to bring the most interesting of the ridge tiles down in one piece.
Get the rest of it cleaned up or not is another thing.
The aesthetics of the roof aren't quite what they used to be, but at least it will now be waterproof. And close up, Ted and Lisa can really see the unique features of the tiles.
I think they are. They look like camel's heads or something, don't they? Look, the mouth.
And Ted and Lisa have a plan to make their unique ridge tiles into a display when they finally open to the public.
What do you think they are?
I don't know. They look like some sort of... Well, really look down like that.
Maybe
with
just
mouth.
Like a gargoyle,
like a cat or something, you know, like sort of Egyptian cats.
At least we've got them.
No, they're nice, aren't they?
They're great.
In central Italy, a couple of hours from Florence, there's another village once abandoned in the drive to modernize. High in the Umbrian hills, Prato di Sotto is now a luxury holiday complex, but for centuries it was home to seven or eight families who farmed the land and worked in the old olive mill. The Borgo was isolated though, and eventually the lure of the towns became irresistible.
It was too difficult to live, to make any money, to move around. I'm told even in the early 60s, a once weekly bus out of this valley. Before that would have been mules.
But Penny Radford, a former marketing consultant from London, has spent the last three decades breathing new life into the village, and it's now completely unrecognisable.
I came here in July 93, surrounded by a group of ruins, no outside lighting, mudslides when it rained. And I had a vision of doing some houses where people felt really at home, furnished with antiques, and would become a home from home for people on holiday.
Penny feels her time as the custodian of Prato di Sotto is up, though. She set her sights on new horizons, and this will be her last summer season. And the sale price reflects what the lost villages of Europe can become with love and passion.
I'm selling for just under 1.5 million euro, and I think it would be a wonderful life for whoever decides to buy it.
It's September 2021, and Prattle de Soto may be about to enter the next stage of its journey with new custodians. It's been on the market for just over 6 months, but today, Penny has a meeting with two prospective buyers, Dan and Andre, who've flown in from Canada. The couple fell in love with the village when they stayed here on holiday.
Hi. Welcome.
Nice to see you.
Dan and Andre's first task is to reacquaint themselves with the village and to explore all of the nooks and crannies they never got to see when they were tourists.
The houses are all private from each other. They all have their own private space, which is very appealing to us.
And their own private outdoor space, too, which is great. You never really felt any of the other guests when you're staying in any of the other suites.
If they do buy the village, Dan and Andre don't want to dilute Penny's vision or risk alienating her returning guests, but they plan to offer new services.
So you'd have maybe delicatessens you could order and they'd be waiting for you in a basket upon arrival. So you'd have like your meats and your cured meats or your vegetables, whatever's in season, first discovering them and then offering it to the guests.
It's taking her vision from 20 years ago and just
modernizing
it or making it current for today's travelers. I mean, the bathrooms in all of the flats are spacious, but they just need to be updated.
Leaving Canada for Europe would be a huge move, but it's one Dan and Andre are now contemplating.
I think it's the opportunity to leave another mark in another country on something. We like renovating houses, we like growing with houses, we like entertaining in houses, and we like Italy. So this is sort of, it answers a lot of different things.
As the boys mull things over, Penny is keeping her fingers crossed that they make an offer. But they're just one of three parties who've expressed an interest, and that should work to Penny's advantage.
I mean, a bidding war would be far too much to expect. But you never know, it could happen.
Coming up...
So we're going to put the pig on here.
The owners of a French hamlet leave their wedding prep till the last minute.
I haven't got a clue what to do.
And we meet the new owners of a unique holiday village in Spain.
The caves were originally built by a Spanish farmer.
A lot of it's got vintage farm machinery on the walls. That's part of the history of those caves.
The Vienne in Midwest France is dotted with abandoned villages, victims of the great economic drift from the countryside to the big cities. But one couple who've always followed their own path are keen bikers Mick and Julie from Manchester. Nearly 20 years ago, they arrived at the tiny hamlet of Les Bruyons, just outside Poitiers, and they've been building their lives here ever since.
At its height, there were up to 48 people living here and working the various fields and land around the place, going back to the 1750s, 1780s, when records started being kept. And now it's just me and Julie doing the best we can with the place.
Mick and Julie first bought a holiday home in Les Bruyons in 2004. But since then, they've acquired 10 other buildings and have moved over full-time.
The reason a lot of people come from the UK to France is affordability. You know, you can have a lovely little country cottage for a fraction of what you'd pay in the UK.
They have two rooms in their home that they rent out, as well as a little gîte and a restaurant. They've also bought two other cottages, the White House and the Professor's, that they plan to renovate and turn into guest accommodation.
We've just not stopped. It was all an accident. We didn't imagine for 1 minute we were going to do this.
It's spring 2021 and there's been an uptick in business at Les Bruyons. With COVID rules lifting, the gîtes are much busier. And since Mick and Julie also plan to reopen their restaurant soon, they need a bigger car park.
I always get the hard jobs. He loves his digger.
There is another reason the couple need a bigger car park. After 22 years together, they're getting married. And the reception will be here in the village.
Well, everything's great, and I think generally people love what we're doing. You know, we're bringing this little village, little hamlet to life.
It's the week of the wedding, and although the car park is done, not all of their plans have come together. They were hoping to have the White House ready for their friends and family to stay in, but it isn't finished. And they'd hoped to have a commercial kitchen installed ready for the reception too.
We were hoping to have it finished for this weekend. Unfortunately, we were let down by suppliers. What was a 4 to 6 week project has now surpassed the 6 weeks, and we're looking at another maybe 4 weeks to get it finished.
With 24 hours to go before Mick and Julie's wedding, there's a special atmosphere in the village, and the celebrations start tonight. The happy couple are hosting a pre-wedding barbecue, and it's a chance to bring their neighbours together.
Well, this is the first time in 50, 60 years that the Brulion has celebrated like this.
Yes.
It's a very special day.
At the reception tomorrow, Mick plans to serve a hog roast to 40 guests, but he's left his prep a bit late.
We have to lift this off. Gas-powered from the heat. And I'm looking at all this equipment and I'm thinking, I haven't got a clue what to do.
Absolutely no idea if we've done it right, but we're hoping it's not going to fall off while it's roasting. Tomorrow.
The following day is set to be the most important day of Mick and Julie's lives. But the weather gods aren't smiling. And Julie's already hard at work prepping salads for the reception.
Today's our wedding day.
Yeah, the idea was it was nice and sunny. And now it's stormy and raining.
Hey-ho.
It makes life interesting, doesn't it?
Meanwhile, Mick is still struggling with his rotisserie machine.
I don't know if there's a secret to the perfect hog roast. I do know last year when we made one, I think it went down a storm, as this will today. But if I can get the thing to light. An hour for every 10 kilogram. So this is going to be 4.5 hours. We'll spark it up about 10:30, which is like in the next 10 minutes. We've got no chance.
Mick and Julie have managed to breathe new life into this long abandoned village, but doing the same to a modern piece of machinery is a totally new challenge. And it isn't one they were expecting on their wedding day. People have been living in caves since the dawn of human history. But the cave houses of Andalusia trace their roots to the Moors, who conquered southern Spain in the 8th century and brought with them a tradition of carving homes into the sides of mountains. There are still communities of troglodytes dotted across the landscape, and some of the old cave houses have been redeveloped. That's where Norwich couple Steve and Julie's story begins.
We came up the hill towards it, and when you saw all 6 Ks and the view, it was just like, wow, this is where we want to be.
About 100 miles from Almería, Steve and Julie have just bought the community of cave houses at Cuevas de la Paz for about the same price as a one-bedroom flat in Norwich. Each dwelling has electricity and running water, but they were first used as animal shelters.
The caves were originally built by a Spanish farmer and he had them for quite a few years.
And you can see a lot of it's got vintage farm machinery. So they're inside the caves and they're obviously outside the caves, on the walls. Not sure what they all do or did do, but that's part of the history of those caves. We are actually sitting on top of the caves. And this is where you get the beautiful stars in the evening time and the complete 360 view of mountains and...
As far as the eye can see.
Yes, as far as the eye can see. Yeah.
Back in the UK, the couple had a recruitment business and lived a very different life to the one they're planning in Andalusia.
We lived in a close. Here, we just have so much space. You know, neighbours, our nearest neighbours is up the hill or down the hill. The caves themselves, they have six bathrooms, six kitchens, six living rooms, six bedrooms. So it's not like you're just going to your kitchen, do the washing up. You've got six choices.
It's January 2021, and today, Steve and Julie are officially taking delivery of their caves. They haven't seen inside properly since they came for their last viewing a few months ago.
We have keys.
Yay! Oh, let's have a look. How many?
Pick a number.
No, don't. Oh, my God. How many? There's a lot there. Blimey.
I reckon we should explore.
Shall we?
Shall we?
Here we go. Number one. Look at this.
Wow.
Really clean.
New home.
Yeah, that's good. Lights. Oh, look at that. Oh, that lovely mirror I liked.
Since they were renovated, they've been used as holiday lets. But they're going to need an overhaul.
Oh, so this is the wall that we need to get fixed, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you can feel it.
No, this is crumbling.
Oh, don't do that.
Why? It's got to come off anyway.
Steve and Julie suspect the flaky plaster is caused by damp because the roof needs a repair.
So this is the room that I think we're going to have the most work done to it.
So we'll just strip it down and redo it.
Yeah.
The natural insulation of the cave walls keeps temperatures between 18 and 22 degrees, so there's no need for air conditioning in the long, hot summers. Some heating in the winter, though, is a must. And there are fireplaces built into the cave walls.
This is a pretty little room. I think it could be a really nice romantic for a couple.
Maybe we should live here.
No, we don't need to be romantic.
No, we don't need a four-poster.
Not surprisingly, when the whole house has been dug out of rock, some of the furniture has also been made from similar materials.
Well, this is quite nice, actually. This one's different. Another stone settee, but with a hole into the middle. Oh. How do we feel? Happy.
Oh, I do. Oh,
yeah. Happy. Really happy. Really happy. Yeah. Very, very happy.
Very pleased.
Yeah.
Steve and Julie will live in one of the caves and hope to rent the others out to tourists by Easter. But there's a lot of work to do first, and it includes building a swimming pool.
Without a pool, our plan isn't going to be what we want it to be. That is a real big worry for me. And also, to have a pool, we have to get electricity from there into here. If we don't get that done by Easter, Easter's when all the Spanish are on holiday, so we have to have it done by Easter. So we have no choice. But the pool, I think, is our
biggest priority.
Biggest priority.
So Steve and Julie have just 3 months to meet their deadline, and it could be quite a challenge. Coming up...
I don't know about you, but it was through my bones last night.
A chill wind is blowing through Montmagny.
That's why I keep drinking so much tea, just to warm my hands up.
And in Andalusia...
And that's exactly what we didn't want to happen.
Steve and Julie hit the road.
I've hit a water pipe.
Winter is definitely setting in at Ted and Lisa's hamlet in Montmagny, where the couple have been working round the clock on their renovations.
Ready?
Ready.
Yeah.
On the ground floor of the chateau, in the apartment next door to the tea room, they've put up a suspended ceiling. and upstairs, the guest accommodation is really taking shape.
I've spent the last couple of weeks, actually, at the sewing machine, making all of the furnishings, making the curtains and the blinds and everything. Ted's finished his woodwork that he's been working on, the nice tops and his lovely door for the fridge to hide away in. So, this is what I have to work with. This is supposed to be a bedroom. Now, Ted's obviously a musician, and they was using the barn to rehearse in, but it has got so cold now. So they've moved their gear up here just to do a couple of rehearsals. I do love this room. The wallpaper, I adore. I was thinking about how could we make this room more French and, you know, have a feel of its own. And I came up one day and I said, oh, I've got a really good idea. Let's wallpaper the wardrobes. And I think they look absolutely fantastic. The four-poster bed will be in the middle here, and it's going to make some curved shelving here as well. So, yeah, so once that's in place, the bed's up, I've dressed the bed, floor down, this room will be finished.
One problem that has sapped their spirits a bit, though, is heating. They've upgraded from living in a tent to living in a caravan, but it's now the end of November and the temperatures are dropping fast.
I don't know about you, but it was through my bones last night, and that's, I haven't really experienced it.
That's why I keep drinking so much tea, just to warm my hands
up. We have two sources of heat. We have the caravan, which is rather nice in the evenings when we're having our dinner. However, the only other source of heat is a halogen lamp heater that is glowing next to my beloved at the moment. And she sits quite happily with that. But you know, I come in here and she's got a hat on and 16 layers and she's still shaking with the cold.
The couple are planning to install a wood-burning stove into the tea room tomorrow. And it can't come a moment too soon.
It will be so lovely to have an open fire that we can huddle around and just sit out, you know.
Yeah, it will be absolutely glorious when we get the fire in.
We won't want to move away from it.
No. 24 hours later, the stove has been unpacked and Ted has enlisted his friend Dave to lend a hand. Their first job is to prepare the chimney flue.
We've got plenty of room.
Hang on a minute, I just want to measure this.
We've had the flue fitted and they've just left it hanging down, fitted it at the top of the chimney. So Dave and Ted are now trying to attempt to cut the flue.
There you go.
Ready?
Yep.
Get going.
Let go. Let it go, yeah.
All right.
We're done.
Mind you, sir.
By fitting the stove with Dave, Ted has saved about €2,000. But they're both learning on the job.
That's it.
And if they don't get it right, there's a danger smoke will leak into the room, either from the stove or from the chimney.
I think it looks good.
I think it looks great. I think it's really, really excellent. Yeah.
It looks like it's a job very well done.
We are going to have your first fire.
Okay, I'll go and get the kitchen. Yay!
Stand up the tree. It is one of those milestones, the fact that we're getting not only power and light in here, but actual heat and self-sufficient heat.
Ted and Lisa's first Christmas in Montmagny is just a few weeks away, and the new stove will definitely sprinkle some festive magic in the tea room.
Oh, I tell you what, it would be really nice, sitting by the fire with a nice cup of cocoa.
Do you drink cocoa?
No.
just the thought of it, yeah.
Back in Andalusia at Steve and Julia's little community of cave houses, it's March 2021. Today, the couple are hoping to take a big step forward in their plan to install a swimming pool in the garden just across the road.
I know Steve's the star of the show today.
They've enlisted two friends to help. And since they're already struggling to open in time for Easter, they need all the support they can get.
Having people here to help us is a big thing for us, really, because we have got so much to do.
We're so behind, aren't we?
We are. Mm. We were hoping to open by April, but we think now it's going to be more like May, because there is so much to do.
When the pool eventually goes in, it'll need power from an electric wire that will run under the road to the garden.
We're hoping there's no electric cables under there and no water pipes. But I only need to go down about 6 inches, so that's not too bad.
Steve has booked an electrician to do the wiring, and he's got permission from the council. But his job is to dig the trench for the wire with an angle grinder.
Oh, I'm very confident.
What is it you're confident in?
That you would be able to dig through the road in a straight line. I have got loads of confidence in you today, yeah. It's just the noise is going to be horrendous, but...
And the dust.
And the dust, yeah. But that's fine, we haven't done any painting yet, so he can dust away.
Hopefully this will work.
But after just 30 seconds of grinding... and with the trench barely an inch long...
And that's exactly what we didn't want to happen.
Oh, Steve.
It looks as though the first 2 minutes of it are a water pipe.
Where's the mains?
You know, I don't know.
Steve needs to shut the water off at the mains, but he's got to find it first.
No stopcock in there.
It's not coming out fast.
It is when you go there.
Well, get up there and get it turned off.
I only went in that far.
Hey, it's still going.
Yeah.
Yeah, give it a minute.
That's not slowing down at all.
As nothing he's tried so far has made any difference to the leak, Steve's plan B is to make another hole in the road.
I'm going to see if I can dig around that water. So I'll need to come in from this direction, away from where it's spurting. And,
Oh, God. Right. No, don't dig any more.
Yeah, I've got to dig a bit more up.
Oh, my good God. All right.
Drama. Here we go.
But his exploratory drilling doesn't quite have the effect he was hoping for.
Oh, no. Oh, that's coming out faster. Oh, God. Maybe I'll have a glass of wine. How early is it? I might need one at the minute. There seems to be, like, a lot of water. Yeah, we've got a pool going on down there now. So we haven't even had a water bill yet, so I don't even know what a water bill will be. Hopefully, it might not be our pipe.
Luckily, the kerfuffle has brought the neighbours out, and they come up with a solution.
The lady at the top there has phoned her husband and he's going to come with someone from the local council.
Oh, are they going to tell us off?
Well, no, they're going to probably help us fix it, I suppose.
Ah.
There's nothing the couple can do except wait and hope that help is on its way.
It's a major disaster, actually, for us, because we were really pushing to be ready for 1st of April, and that just isn't going to happen. Things just take so long here. So, and we really need to get some money in. We're here to enjoy life, but we're also here to earn a few pennies.
Coming up, has Penny finally clinched her deal?
I think what I really miss here is the wonderful guests who come every single year and they regard it as their absolute second home.
And in Les Brions,
that sauce gets down,
isn't
it?
I don't want it.
Love is in the air.
Oh, we see.
It's March 2022 in central Italy, and the little Borgo of Prato di Sotto in the Umbrian Hills is about to change hands. Penny Radford, who's lovingly restored it and spent nearly 30 years as its custodian, has finally sealed a deal to sell it.
2 days ago, we signed the compromesso, which is the exchange of contracts, basically, which ties everybody in. Feels very, very strange. I couldn't really take it on board when I first heard it, but when it actually happened, of course, it was quite a shock to the system.
Penny's prospective buyers, Dan and Andre, who came all the way from Canada to view the Borgo, had a change of heart. And it's been snapped up by a couple from London. But Penny's confident that her passion project will be in safe hands.
The new people who will take it will probably do a makeover. That's what people do when they buy houses, and that's great. But I'm sure they'll respect the bones of the place and the feeling of the place and the character, which is really the most important thing.
Penny has sold the village for just under the asking price of €1.5 million and now has 6 weeks to gather her things and move out.
I think that's a good idea because these are very old pieces, so we can throw those away right away, yeah.
She's getting rid of redundant paperwork, including brochures and guest lists, with help from her friend Sven and gardener Sergio.
Yes, I feel very nostalgic because I remember all the people that came, all the hard work that went into trying to build it and make it work. Some of them come back every year. So it's very, a bit nostalgic.
Sergio's wife, Orietta, has also spent many years of her life working for Penny, and saying goodbye won't be easy for her either. Both women have poured their love and passion into this once abandoned village, so it really is the end of an era.
The trees here I put in 28 years ago, and they're from Nessie, and she remembers all this.
Ma sicuramente sarebbe rimasto come lei da quando è entrata, tutto rudere. E quindi sicuramente, certo, è gente che ci ha fatto lavorare pure a noi.
Dorietta is retiring, she wasn't well last year. Sergio wants to retire, he's getting older. It's time now to start a new chapter.
As she reflects on the last 30 years, Penny knows the village has completely changed her life. She's given so much of herself to it and received so much in return.
I think what I'll really miss here is the wonderful guests who come every single year. Many guests come every year and they regard it as their absolute second home. Quite often we've kept in touch when they're back in England or wherever they are, and we've remained friends.
When Penny first arrived, the village was derelict. Two of the buildings had survived since medieval times, but in the 1960s, as the locals moved away, the walls had started to crumble. And if it wasn't for Penny's vision, the Borgo would have vanished altogether.
I think it took me many years to realise that actually I have created something very nice. Many years. I've always thought it's not quite good enough, I need to do some more of this or more of that, more planting, more painting, more putting tiles down. But in the last 2 or 3 years, people have been saying, you know, you realise, don't you, what you're leaving behind, a fabulous legacy.
Now both Prato di Sotto and its guardian angel are about to enter a new stage in their lives. Penny isn't exactly sure what the future holds, but she is certain she won't be buying another village. She fell in love with this one, and it's an impossible act to follow.
Many people have said to me, why don't you try and do something a little smaller? I love restoring, I love decorating, and I love having guests. So it may be that I end up doing something just on a much smaller scale. Yeah, I'm glad I did it, really glad I did it.
Penny may be heading for the horizon, and the village is about to welcome new custodians, but Prato di Sotto will always be Penny's legacy. Back in France, the little hamlet of Les Brions is about to host Mick and Julie's wedding day.
I'm as nervous as hell. You know, beneath this calm exterior,
I'm a quivering wreck.
Luckily, one thing Mick doesn't have to worry about is the hog roast, because the rotisserie is up and running.
Yeah, it'll be grand. Everything always sort of works out, doesn't it?
It's safe to say, in its 600 years of existence, Les Brions has never seen a wedding quite like it. The couple will be hosting a reception at home with a band, fairground games, a bucking bronco, and there's a retro theme.
They've got a Grease theme, as in the film Grease. So everybody's got to come in 50s dress wear. It's going to be exciting. It's going to be different. I think people will remember this wedding for a long time.
By 3 o'clock, the wedding guests have assembled at the town hall in Bettine. And after 22 years as a couple, Mick and Julie are finally ready to tie the knot.
And I am happy today, Mike and Julie, welcome in France, welcome in Bettine, and welcome in Les Brions.
Merci. Merci. Merci.
Consentez-vous à prendre pour époux?
Oui.
Oui.
OK.
That's supposed to be stout, isn't it?
Back at Les Brions, Mick and Julie's friends, family and neighbours are in high spirits. It's a landmark day for the little hamlet, and descendants of the former residents are here too.
The Professor Jean-Pierre has arrived, and he is the nephew of the owner of the house we lovingly call La Maison de Professeur, after Jean-Pierre.
I've lived in there. I remember my grandfather saying goodbye to me in this room before going to Poitiers to be operated on, and he died during the operation. Suppose I was 4 years old. I think if Mick had not bought it, then this part of the hamlet would have been completely destroyed. So I'm very grateful to Mick.
It really is turning into a day to remember. But as the guests tuck into Mick's hog roast...
That's perfect.
..and the party starts to swing, there's one last surprise in store.
I've just been told that if it rains in France on your wedding day, it's lucky. Go figure. So apparently I'm a lucky man. I am a lucky man, but we don't need the rain to tell me how lucky I am. Whoa. I think we're having a bit of a shower.
Luckily, we Brits are used to a bit of rain, and there's no way a spot of drizzle is going to spoil the party.
It's the whole idea of a little village like this. You know, everybody feels part of it, and I'm sure we're going to look back with delight on what we've achieved.
If we could raise a glass to my beautiful wife, Julie.
Once the wedding is over, Mick and Julie can focus their love and attention on the village again. Before too long, they need to reopen their restaurant, fully install the catering kitchen, and finish their gîte renovations, because it's only by generating income that they'll see Les Brions flourish and guarantee its long-term future. Next time, Ted and Lisa unlock new mysteries below the stairs in Montmagny.
I reckon if you pulled the mud away, there is stone steps underneath.
Steve and Julie prepare for their first guests at the Cave Village.
A bit nervy, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I keep thinking we've forgotten something, but yeah. I don't know what it is.
And in Les Brions,
vegetarian?
Yes.
Ooh la la.
There's chaos in the kitchen as diners order off menu.
Oh my God, I don't know.
Brits just love house hunting in Europe, but not everyone settles for an ordinary property.
This is the key.
It's massive.
All over the continent, there are thousands of historical hamlets, villages and cortijos.
Everything you can see in yellow are abandoned villages.
I guess it's the old high street, isn't it?
Waiting to be rescued from decades of neglect.
They're like, what, you'll actually pay for it?
On this series, we follow the plucky Brits taking on the challenge of a lifetime.
It's an entire village, and I'm just one woman.
Transforming these unloved settlements...
Just wondering, like, where to start.
...into beautiful homes and businesses.
We're officially open!
They will uncover ancient mysteries.
You can see bones sticking out.
...as they breathe life back into their homes.
I don't like to look too closely at this because it scares the bejesus out of me.
So, will they be safe as houses?
I think that's got to be a superior sign.
Or will their dreams come tumbling down?
Do I like swinging?
Oh, just a little.
And that's exactly what we didn't want to happen.
As they restore the past to build their future.
From a one-bedroom flat in London to a little bit of heaven.
We bought a village.
On today's programme, as renovations continue at a hamlet in the Limousin, is there a secret history below the stairs?
I reckon if you pulled the mud away, there is stone steps underneath.
The owners of a cave village in Andalusia get ready for their first guests.
A bit nervy, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I think we've forgotten something, but I don't know what it is.
And?
Vegetarian?
Yes.
Ooh la la.
There's chaos in the kitchen when diners order off menu at a village in France.
Vegetarian?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I don't know.
In Midwest France, about 30 miles from Limoges, are a handful of buildings that once played a crucial role in the development of the French postal service. Back in the 18th century, Momagne was a village that stretched for over 200 acres. And at its heart was a Roulet de Poste, a post house where mail riders would change horses on the route between Paris and Toulouse. By the turn of the 21st century, though, Montmagny was a shadow of what it used to be. Many of the buildings were crumbling, and much of the land was overgrown. But then Ted and Lisa from Norwich moved to France to breathe new life into Montmagny.
It was that tower and the history that did it.
Yeah.
Took us about an hour before we actually went into the property because we were looking at the land and we were looking at the barns and the outbuildings, and eventually the estate agent said to us, do you actually want
do you
to see
want to
inside?
Look in the house?
And we kind of went, oh, yeah, I suppose we ought to.
The couple paid around £160,000 for the estate, which now covers 6 acres and includes a variety of ramshackle buildings, as well as a 10-room chateau with its 14th-century tower. Ted and Lisa plan to turn it into guest accommodation with a tea room. And with a limited budget, they're doing most of the work themselves.
I don't think there's been a day when I've thought, I don't want to do this anymore. I know it's been a limited time, and, you know, I've probably still got my rose-tinted spectacles on, but this is the best job I've ever had. The best job I've ever had.
It's November 2020, and as Ted and Lisa crack on with the renovations, they're constantly trying to unlock the secrets of the past. Today, they're in the tower, where the stone staircase appears to vanish into the earth.
And the way this curves around is as if there's steps that go down further, and there's a huge hole. It's just mud that's built up here, but there's a huge hole. Mm. I reckon if you pulled the mud away, at least to see how far this brickwork goes down.
Yeah.
And we might be able to see whether there is stone steps underneath.
The couple suspect that the stone steps once led to a tunnel that connects either to the medieval town of La Souterraine in the east or the village of Arnac-la-Poste in the north.
So you've got La Souterraine, which has got its fortified church. It's huge. It was a walled city. It's the entrance to La Creuse. It's strategically a really important place.
Yeah.
If this house was important, as we believe it is, then there may well have been that link between the two. Arnac has a fortified 13th century church, you know, and that's 4 kilometres away.
Probably more visible than it going 10 km.
That's the thing. You've got lots of strategic fortified properties around here.
Yeah.
And this great pile of stone that we live in has got to be part of that.
Ted and Lisa would love to get some definitive answers about the steps, but to excavate properly would take a chunk of their budget they can't afford just yet.
It's just going under the surface, i.e. drilling a metre deep hole, is not going to give us anything.
Yeah.
Because it's going to be far below that. We can't do it because we cannot afford to do this, because this is major excavation work.
We'll leave it for a later date.
Yeah.
The couple started the renovations here with a budget of £80,000, and they're getting through it fast. Today, they're about to spend another €5,000 on a tractor.
The tractor's arrived! So we're waiting to figure out how we actually use it.
But with 6 acres to look after, it's a necessary investment.
Merci. Au revoir.
Since it's Ted and Lisa's first ever tractor, they probably should have asked the salesman a few more questions before he left.
You can start it up then?
No. Right, so how do you...
10 minutes later, Lisa is still going nowhere fast.
The oil light's come on. Right, I'm turning it on now. It's red, so... Yeah, it's red. Anywhere.
So Ted has a go. But Ted isn't getting very far either. Until he realizes the tractor is still in neutral. Oh. It isn't a flying start, but at least it's a start.
There'd be no stopping him now. Look at him. Look at the little smile in his face.
The tractor will help Ted and Lisa explore parts of their land they still can't get to and cut down the hours they have to spend working in the grounds. From now on, they can devote more energy to the tea room and the guest apartments. And the sooner they're done, the sooner they can start generating an income. The cave homes of Andalusia come in all shapes and sizes. Some have been modernized, and apart from a few telltale features on the roof, look more like terraced houses. But others have barely changed in hundreds of years, and it's easy to imagine how they were first dug out of the landscape by peasants with the most basic tools. About 100 miles inland from Almeria on the coast, and 735 meters above sea level, is a little community of cave houses called Cuevas de la Paz. Once they were owned by Spanish farmers who lived here alongside their animals, but the new proprietors are Steve and Julie from Norwich.
We definitely want to keep the Spanish vintage farmland feel about it all, but then we also want to just bring in a little bit more luxury and probably make it more for couples so they can come for a nice romantic weekend, but without losing that really good Spanish feel that it currently has. We'd hate to take that away.
When Steve and Julie bought the houses in January 2021, they'd already been modernised and used as holiday rentals. Steve and Julie gave themselves 3 months to spruce them up and hoped to be ready in time for Easter.
We're going to be under pressure for the first few months. I'm pretty sure we're going to be under pressure to get things done, to get things up and running. So that pressure is on.
It's March, and Steve and Julie are in the middle of their first crisis.
And that's exactly what we didn't want to happen.
Steve burst a water pipe when he was digging a trench for an electric cable, and it's created quite a scene.
What did he like? He's not a DIY man, my husband. Don't tell him I said that, though. Definitely not.
Steve and Julie want to put a pool in their garden on the other side of the road. And it'll need mains electricity, so the cable is vital.
He always says, you have no faith in me. I said, I do. Clearly, now you know why I worry.
Luckily, after Steve and Julie's neighbours called the council, two workmen have arrived.
It would appear that I have actually caused quite a bit of damage, which is a little bit worrying, to be fair.
I'm hoping they're not going to give us a horrendous bill here right now. It's definitely not our pipe that he's burst. I think that might be a good thing for us. And the gentleman's saying that it's coming from that way and actually nobody lives there. So that's another good thing.
It doesn't take the workman too long to plug the leak and Steve escapes without a charge.
Oh, I think we're done.
Mucho gracias. It's all dry now, stop.
Ah!
Yeah. Perfecto.
Perfecto.
The repair might be done, but Steve still needs to dig that trench.
Hasta luego. Perfecto.
Luckily, he now has a much better idea of where to start.
So all we need to worry about now is that there's not another pipe in between there and here.
OK. I'm just not even going to look now, so I'm going to let you just carry on. Yes.
So Steve and his friend Mark start work on another trench. This time, it all goes surprisingly smoothly. And soon, it's mission accomplished.
Yeah, we've managed to get all of this gullied out without any more dramas. The pipe up the end there that they fixed is held, so we're good, I think. We're pretty good. There you go. That's it.
Oh, well done. At last.
Once the pool is delivered and connected, Steve and Julie will be ready to welcome their first guests. But with so many jobs taking longer than expected, their April deadline is slipping further away.
We just want to get everything done now, and then we can start, you know, renting the caves out, and then we can start enjoying our life a little bit more. We've got a long way to go, but this is a good start. Well, let me reword that. It was a good finish. It wasn't quite a good start, but it was a good finish. Yeah.
Coming up, there's a kitchen nightmare brewing at a village in western France.
They said they're okay with fish. I haven't got time to make a batter.
I haven't got time to make a batter.
And
we believe that the leak is here.
Pool problems persist for Steve and Julie.
Well, it's just getting dirtier and dirtier, and it's just sitting
it's
here.
It's not working.
No.
For us.
No.
From the medieval masterpiece of Saint-Savin Abbey to the cobbled streets and pretty churches of Montmorillon, the Vienne in western France is a department soaked in history. In the countryside, though, modern economics have sometimes ridden a coach and horses through village life. Here, the landscape is dotted with the abandoned farms and homes of a rural workforce that has drifted to the towns in search of jobs. One couple trying to turn the tide are Mick and Julie from Manchester. They fell in love with the medieval hamlet of Les Bruyons, just east of Poitiers.
Speaking to the mayor, we believe there was property here going back to medieval times, so maybe 1,000 years ago. And the name Les Bruyons is the woods, and this was one of the first clearings coming out of the city that was occupied, cleared for farming, and a family came out, and then another, and slowly it grew to this.
Back home, Julie was an accountant and Mick was a business consultant, but they've spent the best part of 20 years renovating the buildings here themselves.
I've always been sort of a doer, been able to turn my hand to most things. I think it's probably something I get from my dad. My dad was a Sparks, very much a handyman. And as a child, I used to watch him doing things, and it's surprising how much you can pick up. Just watch him.
Mick and Julie have 11 buildings and about an acre of land at Les Bruyons. They rent out 2 rooms in their own house and a little gîte next door as a bed and breakfast. They also have a restaurant that's just reopened after lockdown. But renovations have slowed after Mick injured his arm in a fall from a ladder.
I'm struggling now when I'm getting these boards up because I can't get my left arm above my shoulder. So when the board gets to a certain height, I'm struggling.
Work has stalled on 2 houses they've bought in the village and on a catering kitchen that should be servicing the restaurant.
I should have had it finished 6 weeks ago. But this is just becoming frustrating now because you sort of lose the enthusiasm for it. You know, you come in full guns, get the job done. It's really not encouraging.
It's July 2021 in Les Bruyons, and at Mick and Julie's newly reopened restaurant, tonight is set to be their busiest yet.
You have the town council coming in for the dinner.
12 of them.
12 of them.
And then we've also got the guests that booked into the gîte, 2 adults, 2 children. And they're going to be eating at 7 o'clock.
But we don't know what they're eating yet.
We're just going to present them with the menu, aren't we?
Luckily, the town council has ordered in advance. So Julie has prepped everything she can and is well on top of things.
1 duck provincial, which I actually made last night. 3 duck breasts with cherry sauce. And then we've got 1 duck breast with white wine, no, with wine and chocolate sauce.
Julie just hopes that the family of 4 who are staying in the gîte order something that doesn't take much time.
Just trying to predict. Well, I can't predict what they want to eat. I think they'll go for... They've got 2 children, so there's definitely 2 burgers going to go. Touch wood, they order something simple.
Mick is front of house tonight, and as the French family from the gîte arrive, he's soon into his role.
We have the a la carte and also the full burger menu tonight.
But as they peruse the menu, the family drop a bombshell.
Vegetarian?
Yes, sir.
Ooh la la. Are they okay with fish?
Yes.
Mick and Julie's menu doesn't have any vegetarian or fish options, so it means Julie is going to have to prepare something from scratch.
I'm going to get shot.
And with the councillors due to arrive in less than an hour, it could get very hot in the kitchen.
Vegetarian?
Yeah.
Oh, Michael, I don't know.
They said they're okay with fish. I
haven't got time to make a batter. After shall I fry it?
Yeah, whatever. Two pieces of cod.
It's mid-April at Cuevas de la Paz in Andalusia, and Steve and Julie's holiday village is about to go up market.
Today's so exciting. I'm actually going to own and have a pool.
Yeah. The reason why we got an overground pool was because the cost.
Steve and Julie have paid about €3,000 for the pool, including installation, but hope it won't be long before they recoup their investment.
We are starting to worry about how much money we're spending.
Yeah.
And with the base swept and prepared, the installation team has arrived right on schedule.
We're very excited. Me. I don't know what I forgot what excited is. I need to get my Google out. There is a lot of boxes, though. A lot of boxes there of screws, and there's no way me and Steve could have done that at all. Well, we probably could have done eventually, but it might have took us a month or two.
By the end of the afternoon, everything seems to be going swimmingly.
That's great.
But 2 weeks later, the pool has developed a slow but steady leak.
We believe that the leak is originally here. You can see here where it's not dried up. All the way along there.
Yeah, and here.
And then all the way down the side there.
Yeah. Concrete is just wet here, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's just a pain in the bottom, really, because, yeah. You know, the pool is just getting dirtier and dirtier, and it's just sitting
it's
here.
It's not working.
No.
For us.
No, not at the minute, it isn't. No.
It's a real blow. Having a pool has always been a vital part of Steve and Julie's business plan, and they need to start generating bookings.
We've had the pool erected now for 2 weeks. We've not been allowed to use it. We're about to open up in 2 weeks' time, not to say that we're going to get guests straight away, but we want that pool to encourage more people to come and also more people to stay longer.
It takes a few more days, but after a bit of to-ing and fro-ing with the installation company, it's fixed and ready for guests.
This is my favourite job. I love this job. This, I find therapeutic.
Cheers, buddy. I know. God, so deserve these, don't we?
Yeah.
Steve and Julie may be 4 months behind where they wanted to be, but at last they're in a position to start generating income from their caves. They're listed on a number of booking sites and keeping their fingers firmly crossed for a busy season.
Yeah. Always said I wanted a pool. I did want one of the walk-down, step-down pools, but, hey, girl can't have everything.
No.
I'm in Spain.
I did
I own
my
six
best.
Caves.
I did my best.
Yeah. Yeah, you did your best.
Coming up, the heat is on.
Would you like to come in?
As the town council turn up for dinner.
I don't know who's ordered what, see?
No, I don't either.
And barn life is taking its toll on Ted and Lisa.
Oh, my God, I'm cooking on this, and there's mice droppings all underneath it.
In mid Midwest France, in the village of Les Brions, Mick and Julie have recently reopened their restaurant after lockdown, and tonight is set to be their busiest yet. They need funds from the restaurant to help pay for their renovations, but they've just hit trouble.
Thank you.
After two of their guests turned out to be non-meat eaters, Julie is quickly defrosting fish to make a meal from scratch.
I'm not happy about these fish and chips. I thought we were all going to have burgers.
Mick is front of house, acting as calmly as possible.
I'd go in the kitchen, but I'll get my head snapped off.
Over an hour after the French family first sat down, their main courses haven't arrived, but Mick and Julie's VIP guests have.
Bonsoir.
Ça va bien?
Ça va bien, Mick?
Councillors from the nearby town of Bettine are eating here tonight, and if Mick and Julie make a good impression, they could return on a regular basis.
Would you like to come in?
Yes.
Please do.
Things are getting a bit hot under the collar in the kitchen, though.
How are we doing now? The mayor's just arrived, so you've got me beans and everything.
Yes, Michael. I've just not quite got up to speed with the peas for the fish and chips.
Happily, the fish is ready for their Jeep guests just in time.
Here it is now. Your food is just arriving.
OK, fish and chips.
There you go.
It may be one problem solved. But as Julie focuses on cooking for the town council, Mick discovers another.
I'm going to run out of glasses with the second lot.
You're joking. I've got no way of washing them up because there's just no way you can get to the sink.
I'll sort it.
Hey? It's bringing more stuff back and we've got nowhere to put
it. I'm not bringing the stuff back. Just bringing one tray back.
Out front, the customers are blissfully unaware of the stress in the kitchen.
Yes.
Cabernet d'Anjou?
Yes. Okay, the rosé.
Yes, yeah. Rosé.
And now the French family have finished eating, they're full of praise.
Le repas était très très bon.
C'est vrai, c'était délicieux.
Ils sont tout de suite adaptés. On était végétariens, du coup, ils nous ont proposé de faire un fish and chips. Et ouais, c'est super bon.
With one table now clear, the pressure is finally easing off in the kitchen.
Compute ducks in the oven. Cock of hands in the oven.
But even when the food is done, Mick and Julie have their hands full.
I don't know who's ordered what, see?
No, I don't either.
Okay. Luckily, with a bit of help, the dishes find their way to their rightful owners.
I have burger, the same burger in America. Good, very good, very strong, very good. I'm happy, and I return.
For the hosts, it may have been a stressful night, but it's definitely been a successful one.
Everything seemed to go down well. The mayor seems quite happy. He had a brief chat with me on the way out.
What did he say?
Well, he just said, you know, you're the man sort of thing.
You're the man.
Mick and Julie are closing in on their goal of completely resurrecting Les Brions. Now the restaurant is up and running, they'll have more funds to finish their catering kitchen and to renovate their empty buildings. But there's a mountain of work to do, and as the restaurant gets busier, it's hard to see how they'll fit everything in.
I mean, we keep striving for perfection. There's no such thing as perfection, but
we keep trying. Sort of,
we keep trying for it, you know? You've got to aim for something. It's a good thing to aim for, isn't it?
About 40 minutes south of Les Brions, at Ted and Lisa's hamlet in Montmagny, it's 5 days before Christmas, and the couple have decided to move into the chateau for the holidays. Although they've been sleeping in a caravan for the last 2 months, they've been cooking in the barn, and it's taking its toll.
Morale is kind of diminishing. Every night we come in here and it's so cold and we're having to go into the caravan and not be able to sit sort of outside in the comfort and talk. Oh, my God. Oh, no.
Oh, look at that. Oh, God, this just... Oh, look. This just shows and why it's so desperate that we need to get out of here. Because this is... I'm cooking on this, and there's mice droppings all underneath it, which I didn't even know was there. If we carry on like this, one of us is going to get ill.
The Chateau Tea Room has come on leaps and bounds in the last few weeks. Some of the kitchen appliances have gone in, and Lisa has finished repointing the walls with traditional lime mortar.
The walls have taken a long time, but it's come up great, isn't it?
Yeah, we did all the back wall there, but it looks fantastic. I just am so proud of her for doing all this work. You know, it's an extraordinary achievement. It just looks fabulous.
But to move in here for Christmas, their next job is to put in a bed. And Ted needs to dig it out of the barn, where it's been stored for the last 9 months.
So that's the headboard. That's part one.
The bed is one that Ted built by hand back in the UK.
I made it out of 4-inch fence posts and scaffold boards. All I did was blowtorch them, wire brush them so it brings the grain up, and then I wax them with a clear wax just to give them a bit of protection. And the burning sort of hardens them up a bit.
But to put the bed together, Ted needs some brackets he thinks are up in the attic. So Lisa's off to track them down. There aren't any lights up here, though.
It's like Christmas morning. What's in there?
And the attic isn't just storing Ted and Lisa's belongings. It's also a treasure trove of curiosities from the past.
So you see the state of this box, how filthy it is. But inside is a wedding dress. Completely clean. Look how white it is. Just amazes me how it stayed up here. Beautiful. Wouldn't it be lovely to find out who wore this?
The chateau was owned for hundreds of years by a noble family called the Marcoules. And Lisa believes it may have belonged to them.
And with all this dust and dirt, and it's still so white.
The wedding dress mystery will have to wait for another day, though, because Ted needs those brackets.
Oh, got them! I think that's what he's after anyway. Ted, I found them!
Yeah, no, those are the bits.
Yeah?
Outstanding.
Now he's got all the pieces, Ted makes short shrift of the bed, and they just need to add the mattress.
Right.
So I'm
going to
do these. Ready?
It feels wet, is it?
It's not wet, it's cold.
You sure? Yeah?
Christmas is now just 4 days away, and Ted and Lisa are hoping to cook their first meal in here tomorrow for two friends. It's going to be a busy 24 hours, but with their bed now made, they should at least get a good night's sleep.
Oh, yeah. We've got a crack on with work now, baby.
Have you really?
Come on, get your bum up. Oh.
Coming up, the first guests in the cave homes are due, but Julie's got admin problems.
It's a bit stressful when I really need to be outside and just making sure everything's ready for these guests that are arriving imminently.
And...
Well, yeah, you really smell it there, can't you?
Ted and Lisa's Christmas dinner could be cancelled if they can't light the stove.
The gas is connected and the electric's on, but it's not firing.
It's June in Andalusia, and at Cuevas de la Paz, Steve and Julie are getting ready for their first guests, who arrive tomorrow.
Making that bed, I've got to tell you, took us probably 2 hours. So we probably will get quicker. Well, we'll have to get quicker. Can't take 2 hours just to make a bed.
A Spanish couple are booked into Steve and Julie's most romantic cave home for a night. So their hosts are determined to make sure it's pristine.
See, here we go. Right, I need you to stand on the bottom when I get up.
No, I don't think you should.
Okay. Why?
When you get that height.
Okay, switch it on.
In a cave home, the walls need particular care and attention. Steve and Julie's are covered in a traditional permeable plaster called capofina that causes a bit of dust, so they need regular vacuuming.
They're not high maintenance, but you do need to give them some sort of maintenance. You can't just paint them and then walk away.
The caves just quickly deteriorate, so if you see paint peeling or flaking off, then the best thing to do is to find out the reason why. Maybe there's a bit of damp coming through.
They had damp in here, though, didn't they? It's gone now, but when we came here, this wall was damp because on the roof it needed sealing.
Yeah.
But that's,
we've done that.
That's all done now. So and now we've repaired it, and now it's painted over.
Following day, business is suddenly booming at Cuevas de la Paz.
We've just had another booking, which is brilliant, and this one's for a week.
It's exactly the cash injection Steve and Julie need, but the bookings are bringing their own administrative headaches.
I've now realised, because I've got it on a couple of websites, I haven't taken the dates off on the other website, so I'm now realising I need to quickly do that. Yeah, so it's a bit stressful when I really need to be outside and just making sure everything's ready for these guests that are arriving imminently. But I dare not put these dates on these other websites in case somebody... Because people are booking quite quickly now.
Meanwhile, Steve has some clear-up to do in the car park.
I mean, we got rubbish here. I mean, look, I got a box there full of UK extension leads. Useless. Absolutely useless.
But with an hour's hard graft, and by cleverly hiding most of it with his car...
Should be OK, I reckon.
Steve gets the job done with plenty of time to spare.
Bit nervy, innit?
Yes, it is. Yeah. I keep thinking we've forgotten something, but yeah. I don't know what it is.
And it isn't long before their first guests arrive.
Yeah. We'll just show you around.
You are our first guests.
Yes.
Very first ones, yes. So we're very excited.
Steve and Julie have been practicing their welcome in Spanish. But luckily, Lola and Jose, who are both doctors, speak good English.
So are you? Yeah, that's it. Your keys?
Ah, okay.
Information?
Okay.
And. All the way. Nice and cool. Yes, so lights everywhere. And a very romantic bed.
It's a good place to relax. At the swimming pool, the sun, the house. It's a romantic station for a couple to relax together.
Oh, you did really well, sweetheart.
Did I?
Yeah, you did. Yeah, did really well. Yeah, I didn't have to say a word.
Oh, no, sorry. Sorry to be honest.
Despite Steve and Julie's nerves, it's a great start to their summer, and it's a sure sign that ghost villages of the past, like Cuevas de la Paz, can have a lucrative future. All they need to bring them back to life are dedicated saviours with Steve and Julie's drive and vision.
I feel just like, oh, thank God, now.
Yeah, relieved.
We've worked hard, and I think that it's paid off. They seem to like it. Hopefully, now what we'll learn is, have we provided them with everything they'll need?
Yeah.
In Midwest France, it's been a busy few days for Ted and Lisa in Montmagny.
Okay.
Yeah.
They're trying to get the tea room ready for tomorrow when two friends are coming over to share Christmas dinner. And it's a race against time.
Wait, will it go round?
No. Hold on.
I'm jammed.
If they can't get their dining table through the door, their guests could be eating on their laps.
Not the way.
No. Come back out.
But Ted has a plan.
Can we win?
Go on.
Yeah, it's going.
Careful. Right. Drop it down. Go.
Oh.
Sit. Get the bugger back on this.
Yay!
Right.
Yay!
Oh. Look at that.
Luxury.
Just unbelievable, really.
The last job before they turn in is to bring over the sofa. The couple bought it second-hand and paid only 100 euros.
Where am I putting this?
I don't know.
But Lisa has reupholstered it, and in a fabric that's in keeping with the old French style they're using throughout.
Feels like it's coming together now, doesn't it? Yeah, it's feeling more like it's going to be home for a little while.
Yeah.
Which is nice.
Oh, it is nice, you know.
It's going to look lovely.
Yeah.
The following day, Ted and Lisa are waking up after their first night spent at the chateau in a proper bed.
I think I slept really well. I certainly slept first half of the night.
A little more comfortably,
I think. Yeah, yeah, things don't ache as much.
A cup of tea?
Oh, yeah.
Shall I put the kettle on?
Yeah.
After a quick brew, Lisa's out early to pick some Christmas decorations from the garden.
Tree here, and when we came, it had fallen right over, and we propped it up to see if it would grow, to give it a bit of a second chance, but it hasn't. So I'm going to use the branches from this tree to make a garland to go across the fireplace. So we went rummaging the other day and picked our berries. There's some beautiful berry trees over here everywhere, so I picked a load of holly.
It isn't long before their friends Dave and Karen arrive, and Christmas starts here.
Down the back. And then up on the bottom there.
First, Lisa and Karen need to create the perfect ambience.
Hey! Woohoo!
Wow.
Yeah.
Today will be Ted and Lisa's first chance to use their new cooker.
Well, yeah, you really smell it now, can't you?
But there's a problem with the gas.
The gas is connected and the electricity's on, but it's not firing.
Ted's friend Dave is a bit of an expert with these things, but if they can't sort it out soon, Christmas dinner could be off.
So anti-clockwise, yeah?
Clock, yeah. I'm going to see it now, see if that lights.
9 o'clock, see if that lights.
Luckily, between them, Ted and Dave find a solution.
Well done, Dave.
And Christmas is back on track.
What we had to do is change the jets within the burners so they can accommodate the butane gas, the bottle gas, so they work. And should be good to go for this evening's meal.
Ted's next job is to chop some fuel for their wood-burning stove. But he's still a novice when it comes to some of the vital skills he needs to manage the land here.
I've only ever used a chainsaw about 3 times in my life, and that was here. Never used them before. But there is something I think very Christmassy about doing this sort of business.
Meanwhile, Lisa is cooking up a storm in the kitchen.
Right, let's see where we're at with the potatoes. Oh, lovely. Very nice. So the first meal in our new kitchen, in our new house, in the new country, in France. And, yeah, let's just hope it tastes OK.
As the sun sets in Montmagny, everything Ted and Lisa need for their first Christmas in the chateau has come together.
There you go.
Cheers, everyone. Here's to the best Christmas we can make of it in these circumstances.
Cheers.
And thank you for all your help.
This once abandoned village is again bubbling with life. Suddenly, its glory days don't seem quite so long ago, and Montmagny has a future that's as bright as its past. Next time, there's devastating news at Cuevas de la Paz.
We haven't really managed to do all the things we wanted to do. We did talk about maybe we should go back to the UK.
Walls come tumbling down in Montmagny.
Everybody
it.
Ready?
It's gonna go, it's gonna go!
And there's a heated row over a wonky chimney in Les Brions.
The pressure of the concrete has pushed the pipe across, so it's going to look like the Leaning Tower of Pisa when it's done.
It's going to look ridiculous.